Well, I have to declare the tea break closed. all right, let us, seamlessly into the next session. As I said, we have for this Professor Michael Liebig, lecturer at South Asian Institute of Heidelberg. As you no stranger to us anymore, I mean, if he ever was. And of course, he's going to speak on the concept of clusters and saptanga and shadgunya, underpinning the Kautilyan idea of raison d'etat. And we have Medha Bisht, professor, and she's going to speak to Kautilya's Arthashastra as a functional text of international relations theory. So we go back to the subject, professor, you have the floor.
Let me say, in the beginning, our workshop here is work in progress. And each of those presenting papers, it's for each of us an opportunity to learn from each other. I think that is an important feature of this workshop, as it was in the workshop last May in Delhi, and so that we make maximum use out of different points of emphasis, different foci, different perspectives. Now, what I will present to you now is not my paper, but it is something which hopefully is useful for some. Others may get bored, but we thought it's useful to present it and to help to equalize somehow understanding, or the level of understanding in terms of central ideas and concepts of Kautilya's Arthashastra. So I simply some main characteristics of the text. I believe a foundational text of political theory, theorized statecraft, foundational text of political realism. I will not really elaborate now, simply as a basic overview. It features a holistic understanding of statecraft in the sense of grand strategy involving governance, administration, economy, law, foreign affairs, intelligence, and military strategy. It's all in there. It's, in that sense, it's encoded. It is a theoretical work. It's not a historiographic work. It presents an ideal type polity, an ideal type in the Max Weber sense. The work is normative, instructional, it is experience saturated. Now, we will not discuss the historical figure of Kautilya, of whom we know very little in terms of hard facts. Nevertheless, we can deduce that a text like the Arthashastra cannot be written from a purely theoretical point of view. You need the depths of political experience without which the text is simply not possible, which, by the way, is exactly also characteristic of Machiavelli, who is also an experienced political and diplomatic figure, and the same as Nizam al-Mulk. So the Arthashastra deals with the patrimonial state, the monarchy, and there are now no big theoretical elaborations a la Aristotle's politics on what is the advantage or disadvantage of this and that form of state. Monarchy is kind of given. The book is written, in my view, from an agency perspective. It's not an abstract panoramic view on interstate relations in general. Even so, I think it has a great idea and concept potential that can be used, deep used in that respect. But it takes a very clear perspective, namely the Lichigishu, the conqueror, to become the Shankarvati. But this is not some general imperial design for how do I build an empire, but it is very clearly delineated to the geopolitical space of the Indian subcontinent, and the aim is the political unification of that subcontinent. The most astonishing is that with the many thought figures relevant for interstate relations, that there is no addressing whatsoever of the relations of with states outside Indian geocultural space. And when I talk about India, I don't mean present-day India, but the historical India of prehistoric, pre-modern times. So this is, a very relevant subject which we have to address relations to the Yadoki empires in the succession of Alexander the Great, China, Central Asian state-like entities. Just as we do not have a single sentence on a navy, the naval dimension is completely absent in the Arthashastra. Now, so having said this, what are core concepts of Kautilya's Arthashastra? I would list them as following. In a certain way, the most important for me is the saptanga theory, that is the theory of the seven state factors constituting the state. And when we talk about state, we strictly speak about the patrimonial state. I won't elaborate on that because Professor Mitra did that in the morning. The second is the shadgunya theory, the six methods of foreign policy. Third is the upayas, which are not any original Kautilyan concepts. It's not an original Kautilyan concept, but much older, and simply adopted, which is, to my best knowledge, not the case with the saptanga theory and the shadgunya theory. It's the four means of politics. And I think it is the perfect anticipation of Max Weber's enforcement of defining politics as the way to enforce one's own will against the opposition of others. And we come to the four means in the moment. Then comes the mandala scheme. I call it the mandala scheme because, in my view, I think there is a much over exaggeration of the mandala scheme. It's a configuration of friendly, hostile, mutual, disinterested state, which somehow some people proclaim as the essence of Kautilyan thought, at least with respect to interstate relations, iron law, some geopolitical determination. I don't buy that, and I think it's a configuration that, in my view, is helpful and does reflect certain realities, as Colonel Gautam said, when your neighbor listens to loud rock music that disturbs you a lot more than if in the next street loud rock music is heard. So I think much more important is, in any case, it's just with mandala, it's shifting. There's nothing fixed in it, because once your neighbor has been conquered, your former friend is your enemy, and so on and so as for the next two circles. I think much more important is Kautilya's pre-modern idea. I don't say concept, I don't say category, I say idea of raison d'etat, because the term and the category is absent in the text. However, I say the idea is very much present in the text, and that is exactly the same way with Machiavelli, because everyone believes that Machiavelli invented raison d'etat, but yes, the idea of raison d'etat pervades both the prince and the discorsi, but the term is never, you will not find the term ragion di Stato in Italian, raison d'etat. It's not there. The term has been coined a couple of decades after Machiavelli by another Italian called Moderator, and he defined it as the ways and means to establish, preserve, and expand the power of the state. So in the next key concept, in my view, is political anthropology, the Matsyanaya concept in the Arthashastra, and Kautilya's pre-modern idea, and idea, I don't say concept, theory, or category, but idea of political realism. So first, the saptanga theory, you can read it, I don't have to read it out myself. These seven state factors constitute the state. So the state is conceptually broken down into these seven components, and some of them are material, some of them are immaterial. Of course, the material ones are those which can be assessed if not measured. I can get a pretty good idea what, how big is the rural population, what is their output in terms of grain, what is the tax that can be deduced from that output, the capital also gives is something. What is the population? How many of these populations are artisans? What is their output in terms of products, in terms of goods, artifacts, goods produced? The state treasury can also be measured, how much gold, silver, whatever is in the state treasury. The armed forces can also be measured. Allied foreign policy, Mitra, is that has a special status. It's not a quantitative factor, even so you could make a derivation to quantify it. But it's more similar like the ruler and the government, where quality counts. Now, I think you will note that opposite to the standard understanding of what constitutes a state or the power of a state, the armed forces come pretty low down in the ranking. We see already that when it comes to build up the strength of the state, there seems to be a strong inclination to what, in modern terms, we would call internal balancing. So, a hierarchy of the seven prakriti, and all seven prakriti are logically and substantively interrelated. In a way, each prakrit is the precondition of the next one. And there is a clear value hierarchy, because to put it in crude terms, the fish stinks from the head. So if the prakrit ruler is bad, he ruins the rest. While if state finances are in bad shape, that doesn't really mean as radical an impact upon the other prakrits as if the ruler is incompetent, or if the government, his advisors, and the ministers are incompetent. Now, as I said, they can be evaluated and assessed. And important is that Kautilya makes the difference between current status and developmental trend. And this then is crucial for the question of the correlation of forces between friendly, adversary, or competing states. Now, the saptanga theory leads to, here's the relevant quote, not only that the state is constituted by the seven prakriti, but the power of the state is defined in the Arthashastra as the aggregate of the seven prakriti. And this, I think, is one of the most outstanding theoretical achievements in terms of political science. And I think I said so before. Kautilya sees the Arthashastra as a work of political science. He uses the term political science. And yes, it's there are complications. Book 14 is on occult practices, and book 15 is the most rigorous methodological explanation of a scholarly book of antiquity. I'm not that expert on Aristotle and Plato. Let's say they have a similar explicitness in terms of their methodology, but then it simply means it's co-equal. This 15th book is really extraordinary, and it underlines, yes, this is not some narration, this book fits to scholarly standard. Now, this state power is an aggregate of the seven prakriti. Whoever is familiar with politics among nations will rub his eyes and say, hey, that sounds somewhat familiar in terms of the eight factors of Morgenthau, equally in material ones, geographic location, but not geopolitics. It's industrial base, agricultural base, raw materials, but also quality of government, quality of foreign policy. So they are astonishing homologies, puzzling homologies. Now, I said it already. I think that Kautilya is the intellectual originator of the idea. Even so, the category is not there. Now you may say, what's the difference between idea and category? I would say an idea is a category in its use, but in its use in terms of its idea content, it's the most potent, the most productive, even so, it is not yet as precisely defined in all its dimensions of meaning, in terms of its definitions and the delineations thereof. I suppose I hope you get a sense of what I mean. And here again, I join in what you have said that before. Now, the other exceptional intellectual achievement of Kautilya, in my view, is that this abstract maxim or principle of creating, preserving, expanding the power of the state, which is the standard definition of raison d'état, gains a substantive dimension with Kautilya. Is imperative for the state, for the ruler, to optimize the seven prakriti. So, as power of the state is not an abstract term, but power of the state is defined in terms of these seven prakritis, and I have to optimize them all. They have to be in quantitative and quantitative terms be expanded or improved. And here you have relevant of this imperative to upgrade the prakriti. Now we have the sixth method of foreign policy, they are peace, war, staying in quiet, coercive diplomacy, alliance, and diplomatic double game. Colonel Gautam mentioned them already. My point here is not those as such. Even so, it's interesting. Again, a point strongly emphasized by Morgenthau, that the avenue, the set of available foreign policy options is never indefinite. It's a restricted set of options under any imaginable situation in interstate relations, says Morgenthau. And so says Kautilya 2,300 years before. He says there are six methods and not seven and not ten, it's six, also not five. So the real point is that the choice of these options is determined by an objective assessment of the situation, which means an objective assessment of the correlation of forces in terms of the seven prakriti between competing or adversary states. So the element of arbitrariness, of gut feeling, of hunches in terms of foreign affairs is eliminated. There is a clear benchmark. There are precise criteria. The choice of your foreign policy, one of those six, is first of all, I would not necessarily say exclusively, but primarily, first of all, determined by the correlation of forces in terms of the prakrit. So you have to look at each prakrit and compare it, not just current status, but developmental tendency. Are they stagnating, rising, declining? Because that's the other point for Kautilya, there's never standstill, fluidity in relations between states and conditions of states. They are always fluid between these three states, by the way, exactly as with Machiavelli. So each of them you have to correlate, and the combination, the aggregate, you have to correlate. Now, then you come to certain conclusions, which are not, should not be seen as a rigid, deterministic, mechanistic, but they give you the basic directionality. Is your adversary superior and is likely to remain superior in the foreseeable future? You make peace. Is your adversary vastly inferior, so that the cost of war, and let's be absolutely clear, I think it has been underlined several times, war is ultima ratio, as in the strongest possible terms. The Kautilya is certainly no tyrant of Ahimsa, but war is the last resort. I could elaborate, but that's not our point here. So if there's balance of power, stay quiet, neutrality. Your own power is rising, then you can begin to make pressure, coercive diplomacy. Your own power is deficient and likely to remain deficient, make an alliance. I would say, without elaborating now further, Kautilya is no friend of alliances. Alliances are something also almost ultima ratio. And if we look at blunt alliance policies of Nero, I always wonder, did Nero invent that? Or was there a certain inspiration? After all, we know that he read the Arthashastra. Nehru read the Arthashastra in prison thoroughly. And this is all documented. if the situation is very fluid, then you go to Dwaipaba, diplomatic double gate. Now, the point I really try to make is, because it demonstrates the superior theoretical and intellectual capabilities of Kautilya, is the intrinsic connectivity between the shadgunya theory and the saptanga theory, and this is not some interpretive deduction. He states it himself in unmistakable terms. And yes, that's basically what I wanted to say. Thank you.
Thank you, very good. Now we'll move straight to Professor Medha Bisht.
So good afternoon, everyone. Well, let me just sort of mention at the outset that my paper is titled as Arthashastra Reflections on Thought and Theory. And let me sort of put it here very clearly that I would dare not call it as one of the foundational texts of international relations theory, primarily because saying that would essentially be putting the cart before the horse, without qualifying the essential causal or generic assumptions that Arthashastra as a text rests upon. So rather than making an assertion right at the outset that Arthashastra is a foundational text of IR theory, in fact I would follow it up with a question mark and then perhaps address this very question in a systematic way. Now, one of the key questions I assume that should concern every student of international relations theory is to answer the question, how is it that Arthashastra moves from thought to theory? And it is in this context that I would like to add that theorizing Arthashastra therefore could in fact be a very daunting task to begin with. Well, there are two nodal points that my chapter would rest on. First, it explores the possibilities of theorizing Arthashastra as a text. And in order to examine this question, I focus on the theoretical relevance of Arthashastra. And second, I will not restrict Arthashastra to a paradigm-driven framework available in international relations. And in fact, that is, I will not restrict it to constructivism or realism, because I would suggest that going beyond paradigms, particularly towards an inter-paradigmatic space, can be helpful in understanding the meanings of certain concepts and ideas which are articulated in the text itself. So in this context, the significance of inter-paradigmatic treatment to understand concepts and values which emerge from cross-cultural encounters has been emphasized upon. Well, I've operationalized my ideas through three specific sections. In the first section, I will examine the possibilities of theorizing Arthashastra. In the second section, I would engage with the conceptual expositions and operational parameters elicited in Kautilya's Arthashastra. The concept of order and its broader relationship with morality has been discussed in this context. And in the third section, I would highlight the necessity of going beyond paradigms and moving towards an inter-paradigmatic framework for situating and interpreting non-Western intellectual resources. So coming to the first section now, in order to respond to the critical question of moving from thought to theory, I think we need to first understand the critical conditions which are required for understanding a theoretical enterprise. A theoretical enterprise which, to my mind, is broad enough to encompass the diverse forms of theorizing which has really animated the field of theory. And I would briefly flag out three distinct parameters which help elevating thoughts to a theoretical enterprise. The first strand is related to empirical and normative conditions which should inform the exercise of theory building. Now, it has been argued by many scholars that imperative and normative dimensions and the deep interconnections is unavoidable when one is thinking about theory. And I found this discussion particularly interesting because Arthashastra as a text reflects an attempt to bridge the gap between the desirable and the feasible in the most nuanced of all ways. While it does not have an exclusive normative and empirical thrust, it nevertheless aims to extract the essence of Hindu political thought and tradition to illuminate the social and political phenomena of the time and make sense of the interconnectedness between state and statecraft. Another important discussion while theorizing international relations is the nature of theorizing per se. And in this context, many scholars have argued there are three essential conditions or parameters for theorizing. First, that it should have an explanatory value. Second, it should have a causal mode of reasoning. And third is that it should be parsimonious, which means that it can lay out some general underlying assumptions around which a pattern exists. Now here I would like to invoke Kenneth Waltz, he sort of gives this difference between laws and theories, because he says that one of the factors that differentiates laws from theories is the process of explanation, as explanations reveal why associations or patterns exist. The fact that Waltz emphasizes that theories are not invented but discovered is interesting because that underlines the need for identifying an underlying order which makes sense to the causal hypotheses one intends to examine. And here I would like to get in Arthashastra and ask a question. Is there an underlying order in Arthashastra? And do arguments in Arthashastra follow a causal mode of reasoning offering explanatory richness? My answer is yes, and I've argued that the saptanga and the shadgunya theory become relevant in this context. Now coming to the third parameter, which is primarily about creative theorizing, I would say that Arthashastra again was to be read within the broad parameters associated essentially with the art of theorizing, that is creativity. Certain factors again stand out, and attempts could be made to reflect on whether Arthashastra holds any theoretical value. So if one was to engage with the primary assumption that Arthashastra makes regarding the big referent questions, the answer could be really found in the exclusive focus which is given on the understanding or the rationale of the state per se. The state was not just an artificial construct, but a personification and an embodiment of righteous conduct conveyed through the notion of dharma. dharma, as I argue in this chapter, in this paper, was essentially a via media through which morality and order interacted with each other. Similarly, questions related to the relevance of matters in international relations, political universe, can be addressed through the pertinent focus that Kautilya gives to order. Order was considered central in Arthashastra primarily because of the importance given to the concept of state through the saptanga theory and statecraft through the mandala theory. I found this definition given by C. Prakash in particular illuminating when he wrote that the state enabled the citizens to follow their respective dharma and to enjoy private property rights. The role and place and the meaning of dharma, therefore, is a matter of much deliberation, and in this context, its meaning in terms of morality and order becomes significant. Now, given that I do not have time to really get into the details of the paper, assuming that the paper will be circulated, I would briefly speak a bit on the conceptual categories of morality and order, and then move on to the discourse on the interparadigmatic treatment of these concepts, getting the theoretical argument in perspective. Now, coming to the conceptual category of understanding morality, I would say to understand morality, the means and debate becomes very significant because it has been one of the recurring dilemmas in international politics. In this paper, I have argued that specific philosophies and cultures within which these justifications of state or morality are embedded become significant object of phenomenological analysis. To my mind, the end means debate becomes relevant because of two reasons. First, it tries to reconcile the logic of morality in politics, and second, it explores the rationale, that is philosophical and cultural, which go behind the understanding of a given political action. And it is this second logic which makes it necessary to examine the text within the philosophical tradition and the evolution of the history of ideas per se. Now, I have tried to sort of operationalize this this means and relationship by particularly focusing on three frames of analysis. The first frame of analysis primarily looks at the ideational genealogies of the concepts, morality and order. The second primarily looks at the philosophical genealogies of the concept, and the third primarily looks at the historical insights on the ideas of the state and the social changes of the time. So if one really looks at the ideational genealogies, Kautilya's Arthashastra becomes important from a means and perspective, primarily because it introduces an important element of dharma, which can also be translated as political virtue or political wisdom. Kautilya's notion of dharma is significant because it not only has categorical leanings, but also balances desirable elements of polity with the feasible elements of policy. And it is in this context one can also say that this balance can be found at the intersection of morality, dharma, and policy niti in Arthashastra, which was articulated through the embodiment in the notion of the state itself. The state thus was a normative construct and embodiment of dharma itself. To understand dharma in a more nuanced level, B.K. Sarkar's explanation here becomes appropriate. Now, Sarkar subjects the notion of dharma within three distinct strands. He writes that in Indian political thought, dharma can be interpreted as law, duty, and justice, where state is a law-giving institution, justice dispensing institution, and duty enforcing institution. The distinction between state and non-state is thus illuminated through the state of order, which is dharma, and the nadi, matsinyane. And in this context, one can say that the state, therefore, emerged as an instrument of ordering social relations towards minimizing the impact of specific elements which could trigger anarchical conditions. In Matsinyane, anarchy, as Sarkar writes, there is no law, no justice, no duty. The state, therefore, in fact, becomes then the originator of law, justice, and duty. Philosophical undertones of Arthashastra also requires that one tries to examine the basic methodologies which the text uses. And an explicit mention of anviksiki, the three Vedas, economics, and science of politics become relevant in this context. The concept of anviksiki, as it has been sort of referred to before, is considered distinct to Kautilya's Arthashastra, as it is not only underlines the balanced nature of the text, clearly distinguishing it from the Dharmashastra tradition, but also from the Mahabharata, which does make a mention of the sciences, but nowhere reflects the importance of anviksiki, that is philosophy. V.P. Verma, one scholar, defines anviksiki as dialectics and considers it significant given its investigative and critical nature. Verma argues that in Arthashastra, dialectics aids not only the Vedas and the Varta economics, but also Dandaniti, punishment or the use of force. According to K.J. Shanand, the scholar, Anviksiki as a term is instructive, as Kautilya has clarified its meaning through the employing certain examples. He argues that the philosophical terms such as Samkhya, Yoga, Lokayat are illustrated, and that the meaning of Anviksiki should not be restricted to these different systems of thought. Shah considers Samkhya, Yoga, and Lokayat as primarily symbolic and representative of the Hindu body of thought, because Kautilya's main aim, according to him, was to secure unity of thought, speech, and action between different philosophical strands. His basis of saying so are the different leanings with Samkhya, Yoga, and Lokayat philosophy entailed. Citing Kautilya's Arthashastra, he argues that Anviksiki was therefore a form of rational inquiry into dharma, adharma, good and evil, earth, unearth, economic and uneconomic, naya, apanaya, politic and impolitic, and the relative strengths of these three in politics. Anviksiki in Kautilya's Arthashastra thus served a threefold purpose. First, its goal was to unify the thought, speech and action of individual and society. Second, since the description of goals and theoretical systems to support them were different in available philosophical traditions, Kautilya thought it was perhaps expedient to synergize the system with the goals of the state. And third, the four sciences enunciated by Kautilya were universal and not sectarian in character. Anthony Tarrell emphasizes that Anviksiki becomes an element of pluralism in Arthashastra. He argues where Samkhya and Yoga dealt with issues of spiritual liberation, Lokayat dealt with issues of materialism, thus conveying the message that philosophy was neutral and secular as far as the basic assumptions of the various systems of knowledge was concerned. He further writes that Arthashastra's basic role was to make the sciences argumentative in character, as Kautilya intended to convey the systems of spiritual philosophy could develop only when they become argumentative and dialectical. In Kautilya's view, therefore, philosophy or Anviksiki has an important place given its neutrality and the very development of spiritual philosophy dependent on Anviksiki. Meanwhile, the reference of Vedas in Arthashastra, Sam, Likat and Yajur, make Arthashastra being identified with the Arthashastra tradition. Kautilya writes, the law laid down in this Vedic lore is beneficial, as it prescribes the specific duties of the four varnas and the four stages of life. Kangri notes that it is only in the Dharma Sutras, a branch of Vedanta Kalpa, that the duties of varnas and ashrams are laid down in detail. However, given the logical emphasis of Anviksiki, And a question which can be asked is that, is the reference of two Dharmashastras then merely instrumental? While it might be instructive that Kautilya intended to make reference to Dharmashastra for purely instrumental reasons, given that he preferred to use the word Veda instead of terms like science of Dharma or Dharmashastras, K.J. Shah has considered this usage unimportant, as among the sources of Dharma, Shruti as a source has been mentioned in Manusmriti. Thus, according to him, Vedas are Shruti, and Anthony Parrell, on the other hand, sort of considers the specific terminology of Vedas being invoked for a specific point. According to Anthony Parrell, Vedas, seeing has priority over reasoning, and only after seeing does thinking, reasoning, speaking, writing, and acting comes. However, given that Kautilya emphasized on four sciences, where philosophy, Anviksiki, is considered to be a lamp of all sciences, the influence of Dharmashastras on Arthashastra requires further investigation, as Anviksiki was dominantly emphasized upon. Now, from the historical perspective, Romila Thapar is of the view that by about 600 BC, the broad patterns of Indian history started becoming much clearer. By this time, permanent settlements in particular areas had been geographical identities to tribes which were gaining concrete shape due to the possession of geographical territorial areas. To maintain these possessions, therefore, it was necessary that political organizations, either in the form of monarchy or republican governments, were being contemplated. Thapar's broad argument is that while the state was regulatory in character in terms of monitoring the roles of various organs and administrative structures, theories regarding the origin of state during the Mauryan times was a shift of focus from Rajanya, who protected the Jats, to the Kshatriya, who both protects as well as maintains law and order. Ultimately, she writes, when the Kshatriyas were not sufficient, the state was visualized as an intermeshing of seven limbs, prakriti or angas, among which the king was but one element. Another historian, Ashok Chowdhury, writes that Arthashastra teachers were influenced by the course of social revolutions and wanted to develop the source of Artha to create material prosperity. Different Arthashastra teachers therefore represented different schools of thought as they propagated different ideas. According to Kautilya himself, there were as many as 10 predecessors before him. Chowdhury also writes that the tradition of Arthashastra was a consequence the alternative thoughts that were emerging since the 6th century BC. The 6th century BC, according to him, was the beginning of feudal revolution when the kings used amoral methods to get things done. Amongst the various schools of thought that emerged in ancient India, be it the supporters of traditional Brahmin religion based on Vedic dogma or sacrifices, or the anti-Vedic religious teachers like Buddha, Mahavir, and Musal, and Lokayat or Arthashastra teachers, the Arthashastra teachers tried understanding the causes of new change and advocated that the force of change could be strengthened with the help of the institution of the state, which was the embodiment of Dharma. The historical condition perhaps revealed why Dharma or the state was essential to the maintenance of order. Now coming to the concept of order, Danda formed the central pillar which supported it. Kautilya writes, the king severe with the rod becomes a source of terror to beings. The king mild with the rod is despised. The king just with the rod is honored. For the rod used after full considerations endorses the subject with spiritual good, material well-being, and pleasures of senses. Used unjustly, whether in passion or anger or in contempt, it enrages. Now, as can be sort of seen from this paragraph itself, dharma and order were thus deeply correlated, and Danda emerged as the means of regulating this order. On the preponderance of dharma, Arthashastra points out that in a situation where dharma and niti contradict each other, dharma should provide the direction. Arthashastra thus was a mediating link between the secular issues related to niti, policy, and the issues related to dharma, morality. Anthony Perel's understanding in this context is interesting because he argues that one of the most important ideas that took roots in Arthashastra was the relevance of political science as an important discipline. This, as he argues, was to create cultural conditions necessary for the pursuit of four great ends of life, the purusharthas, dharma, artha, kama, and moksha. Now coming to IR theory now, one was to give disciplinary primer to international relations theory. Anarchy as a concept will stand out in all its prominence. Kenneth Wall's neorealist considers anarchy a central structural feature of the international system. The anarchical nature of the international system with no superior authority thus makes states fend for their own security and survival. The primary contribution of Kenneth Walls was theorizing the international system, and Walls successfully did so by laying the three ordering principles of international system, anarchy, and undifferentiated nature of states and distribution of power between states. The international system for Walls was an independent variable characterized by anarchy and self-help. It gave rise to competition between states, often seeking to augment their power and enhance their security. The second variable elicited by Walls is, however, important as it laid emphasis on the undifferentiated nature of states. Kautilya's Arthashastra considered saptanga theory a key explanatory variable in influencing the choices of states. This is one of the primary differences between the Wallsian and the Kautilyan analysis, as Walls provides a descriptive framework and Kautilya, I would say, a normative one, as the capacity of the state has been given exceptional emphasis. However, I would add that Arthashastra bears close resemblance to classical realism, since it does emphasize on balance of power politics. Nevertheless, having said this, I will also add a caveat that balance of power suggested by Arthashastra also stems from the need to regulate order. An appropriate example for arriving at this understanding is the spoke and hub analogy which Kautilya uses in chapter 6. He writes, making the king separated by one intervening territory, the ferry, and those immediately proximate the spokes, the leader should stretch him out as the hub in the circle of constituents. There were 72 constituent elements which Kautilya mentions of. The superiority and inferiority of state within the mandala was determined by not only alliances, but also the other 6 constituent elements defining the state, where maintaining and preserving the constituent elements was the dharma of the state per se. In this context, I would argue that order, and therefore not anarchy, is more instructive in understanding Arthashastra. So finally, where does one situate Arthashastra? within the broad theoretical discussion in international relations theory. Now, epistemological frames are important for guiding methodological inquiries that one adopts in the course of understanding how knowledge has evolved over a period of time. One of the main reasons why I would say it would be inappropriate to study Kautilya's Arthashastra within the frameworks of international relations theory is the context of embeddedness of the text in the tradition per se. Most of the concepts employed in international relations are contextually embedded in Western philosophical tradition, which has often limited epistemic contributions from the epistemological and the ontological point of view. Now, Jiang Long Jiang offers a useful way out as a methodological reflection to cross-cultural encounters or comparisons. Jiang argues that general comparisons cannot be made at the level of concepts and propositions, but can only be achieved through inter-paradigmatic conditions where we have a sharp awareness of the paradigm boundary from which we can attempt to achieve a situational communication with other paradigms. In this context, it is argued that situating Kautilya as a realist or a constructivist is neither important nor relevant. However, where ideas and concepts can help is in identifying the situational awareness of the text in between paradigms, and the conceptual nuances that therefore inform such process can help in understanding the ontological and the epistemological contributions that non-Western intellectual resources make to concepts used in international relations. Thus, from the theoretical vantage points, while Arthashastra might appear to echo shades of realism, neorealism, constructivism, etc., its explanatory richness stems from the interconnectedness which lay at the foundation, of the political system of the time. It thus needs to be perhaps reinstated that while much has been written on the realist undercurrents of Kautilyan thought, which is both ontologically and epistemologically problematic, few studies have been undertaken to understand Kautilya's Arthashastra from a systems perspective. Ontologically then, I would argue, Kautilya's identity is that of a system theorist. And this is significant because the concepts of power, order, morality find significance within this broad framework. It is for this reason that this paper intentionally avoided the possibility of studying the concept of balance and order from a realist, neorealist, constructivist perspective. The primary reason for doing so was to trace the identity of Kautilya as a grand strategist. And given the relativist understanding of the concepts like morality, order, power, which can be defined, redefined, revisited as per the limits set by each of these theoretical paradigms, an attempt to understand Arthashastra as a text both of philosophy and strategy, to my mind, would have got compromised in due process. It would therefore be appropriate for me to conclude that one should treat Arthashastra then as a work proximate to that of systems theory, a work which focuses on the notion of order and balance in the political system and the implication this holds for understanding the interconnectedness that existed between the parts and the whole, or within the internal elements of the state and the external policies which the state employed.
You mentioned the anarchical nature of international society. Of course, you mentioned it was, but you know that it was Hedley Bull who saw the system of states as a consequence of the anarchical nature of international system in the anarchical society. Anyway, and Bull was mentioned earlier this morning, two times. Yes, I'll open the floor in this order, Professor Subrata Kumar Mitra, and thereafter Rahul Mukherjee. I was going to recognize you anyway, but if you didn't raise your hand, and Sindh Balsam thereafter. Quick, short interventions and shorter responses.
Thank you. One of the central problems of all states is how to economize the use of power. My question is to both speakers. Sometimes this is expressed in the form of a Latin expression, quis custodiet custodes, who will police the police? Because no state can have as many policemen as men, and if it did, who will police the police? In that sense, both of you have shown very elegantly and effectively how Kautilya transforms force into power, power into authority, and authority into legitimacy. However, the issue of the state is not just how power is generated or used, but to what purpose. That's where the slippage sinks in. The slippage we have seen already in the paper of Saurabh. Saurabh Mishra's paper shows, at least to me, that Kautilyan state uses power to speed people on the long road to moksha. But then that would make him a Hindu thinker, and would a Hindu thinker have any space in our times in a secular democratic state?
Okay. Fascinating presentation. But I think we have to address some important questions in theory. I don't think Dr. Liebig is doing that. Dr. Liebig is saying that there are some theorists who invoke, but he's not giving us really a theory of international politics coming out of Kautilya. In that respect, Dr. Bisht, I think, has made a very valiant attempt. However, that attempt sort of confuses me, because in the name of interparadigmatic, I don't understand how you can escape the question of theory, because you are invoking unviksiki and dialectics, right? Now, if unviksiki is dialectics, then it can produce a social construction. And if you go to Alexander Wendt's theory of international politics, social construction is a dialectical construction. I mean, he's not using Marxist terminology because he's somewhat of a more liberal. You are saying that it is anarchy, but there is dharma, right? It is anarchy, but there is dharma. Anarchy, I can understand. But what kind of anarchy? I mean, Wendt will at least say that there's a Lockean anarchy, there's a Rousseauian anarchy, there's a Hobbesian anarchy, right? Is anarchy static in Kautilya? What are states in Kautilya? From the dispositions by Dr. Liebig, it seems that the states are more like the Helen Milner type, you know, not like the Wallacean type. That, you know, the domestic is very, very important for understanding the international. And that anarchy is not such an unusual construct, because many of the things that you describe in anarchy are also present inside of states. And the states are not as hierarchically ordered as you will find in Kenneth Waltz. So if the states of Kautilya are so domestically determined, are we looking at states as billiard balls? And if we are looking at states as, suppose that we are looking at states as billiard balls, are we looking at states as billiard balls who are rational in a unique way? Or is rationality also something that can become a social construction? So there are actually a lot of problems in theory. One is that what is the state? I mean, the state for me, which interacts with the global actors, is not, you know, just one Prime Minister Manmohan Singh at a point in time connecting with IMF or World Bank. It's a much deeper story, all right? But balance of power theorists and security studies people like to think of a state as a billiard ball where there is a certain kind of rationality, right? So I think the first question to sort out is that what kind of an actor is it and how unitary is it? The second is, if it is unitary, then life becomes simple. It seems not, because there is this huge domestic structure that is being invoked. Then what is the nature of that interaction? In what kind of an environment? Does dharma play into the action of the states, or does it play into the construction of their environment? Do the actions of the states in interaction produce their environment? And then, if you resolve these questions, you have to answer, it seems like there is some statements would make you believe that, you know, Kautilya is a hegemonic stability theorist, you know, he's talking about Chakravarti. And then some of you are saying that he's a balance of power theorist. Balancing and alliance behavior can take place among unitary actors, but it can also take place among actors who have a mind of their own. In fact, Waltz became so difficult to defend that Stephen Walt and Paul Schroeder onwards, all his students and his followers had to start giving identity to those actors, right? So the point I'm trying to make is that this is a very valiant panel, because, you know, for the first time, I'm getting out of the manual and now trying to see behavior. You know, this is really what excites me. And that's
That's probably the reason why I do most of the official work, because I like to get to behavior. But I think, so it's exciting that we have those questions on the table, but I think running away from answering those questions won't take us very far in theorizing Kautilya.
But you don't have much time to answer those questions anyway.
Thank you, just following on a bit from what Rahul has said, this theory and practice thing is a very difficult thing to negotiate. A lot of IR theories have tried. And become question for each. Dr. Liebig's last slide, he made in my opinion, a kind of throwaway comment saying, Nehru read Kautilya, therefore Indian foreign policy under Nehru is influenced by Kautilya. I think that's a bit hard to defend, because Nehru read a lot of other stuff as well. So how do I think the causality there needs to be defended a bit better. Just a comment, I'm wondering what you think about that. Dr. Medha, I thought excellent, really, really nice. People don't do enough IR theory in India. Most of the time, Indian foreign policy in India is classified quite simple. Nehru idealist, Indira realist, BJP nationalist. Thank you very much. End of lecture. Obviously, there's more to Indian foreign policy than that. But there's a question to you, following up from Rahul. Do you not think that, in a sense, you are trying to fit Kautilya into some kind of box? Right? You've got this range, this Western pantheon of actors. Modern Tao, Waltz, the normal crew, systems theory. And then you're trying to fit, just trying to push, shove it in. Is that a useful enterprise? I'm just wondering. Right? But okay, funny enough, at the end, you actually say something really interesting. Say, why don't we just take this as a philosophical text? Right? I'm wondering what your thoughts are there. I thought really interesting. Thank you.
See, ISAS workshops are not for the faint hearted. We put the reverse of that. We have Dr. Bisht first and Dr. Liebig.
Three minutes each. Very interesting question for the table. And, I know.
Yeah, 3 minutes each.
I think some very interesting questions on the table, I just so try to answer them systematically. And,
but not for very long. Because
okay, not very long. So, enough for Professor Mitra's question. Professor Mitra, you asked that, okay, how does one rationalize the use of force? Is that the question? Where does that country use force? Okay, so let me just answer it, maybe, you know, and I'll be able to, respond to your question. I think why one uses force is to sustain order. And how does, so order is one of the primary elements. And how is order defined? Order is defined primarily through the saptanga theory, the seven elements of the state. And within those seven elements of the state, if the third element, that is the people, the state is not delivering its duty of the yogashema, which is the well-being of the people, then the state somewhere has to go in a corrective direction. So force. So danta and dharma, you know, in that way, they are in dialectics with each other. But the use of dan is to sustain the dharma. And dharma of the king, or the duty of the king, is to protect the people. And that is really the end goal of the state. So even when we really look at the mandala theory, the foreign policy of in Arthashastra is primarily an extension of the state. Because if you look at the seven constituent elements of the state, the ally is in fact the last one. The ally is just one constituent element. Coming to Professor Mukherjee's question, I think, you know, why I use the inter-paradigmatic space in order to understand Arthashastra, primarily because you can classify him as a constructivist, you see echoes of realism, neorealism, you did talk about the hegemonic stability theory, so there are questions there, you know, and first is that. Second is that here what we're really trying to do, we're trying to get in the insights or ideas from non-Western political, non-Western intellectual resources, and then try to understand them in terms of the way we understand concepts in international relations theory. So here I wouldn't really argue like Gadamer sort of argues in terms of taking ideas and concepts towards a fusion of horizons. We are not really trying to see that, okay, there is a meeting point which is possible, and there is where you know, these insights from these non-Western texts become important. My whole argument with this whole approach of interpreting Arthashastra is that you need not be restricted to a particular paradigm, which could be a resemblance of ideas of sorts, because Arthashastra as a text is about is talking about many things. And the way I see Kautilya's Arthashastra, this is particularly Dr. Sindhapal's thing, I see him as a grand strategist. I see him as a grand strategist who is really trying to look at the interconnections which exist. And in that context, I do qualify him as a systems theorist, because he's trying to regulate the political system. At the psychological level, perhaps by using dharma in a very instrumental way, by going back to the Veda or the order, you know, the social order he's talking about. So that's been used in a very instrumental way in Kautilya's Arthashastra. Because, you know, I mean, when I was preparing for this, when I was reading, there was one particular chapter, I guess, the Shudras in Early India by Arya Sharma, I came across. And there he clearly mentions that even the Shudras were brought up in the Kautilyan army. So if one would really like to put that in perspective, you know, how do you define grand strategy? Grand strategy is about using all the available means you have to achieve a desired end. And the desired end here was the preservation of the state. You know, if I would like to put it that way. And that is one of the primary, yeah. So how is anarchy static? Now once you take anarchy as one of your fundamental points, and there is where I think the paradigm of realism, though there are, you know, so one can say that Hans Morgenthau's argument of classical realism is primarily normative, because what Morgenthau is essentially doing, he's essentially talking about order, he's essentially talking about balance. You know, statecraft is done for the purpose of balancing the international system. Kerenfels, on the other hand, is providing a more descriptive approach. You know, how is it that patterns emerge in the international system? But as a consequence of war, definitely, Kenneth Walls is not talking about order. Now, when I really get Kautilya in, you know, Kautilya, to my mind, there is clearly a cosmic perspective in the text itself, the cosmic perspective of order and dharma. Dharma, etymologically, if you translate it, it means dharya, which means to hold. So the state itself was the holding power. Now, if you really look at the mandala, so, you know, it's interesting, and some of the details are there in my paper. The mandala, in fact, is composed, and that is what fascinated me when I looked at the concept of mandala and went into detail, the 72 specific elements which Kautilya talks about. Now, what are these 72 specific elements? The 72 specific elements, I would say, normally it is understood in terms of the rings there, but I would say they are four specific rings. The first ring is basically the conqueror, the ally, and the allies, allies. The second ring is the enemy, the enemy's ally, and the enemy's ally. The third ring is the conqueror, the enemy, and the neutral power. The fourth ring is the conqueror, the enemy, and the middle power. Altogether, he says that all of these states have six constituent elements, and there is where, you know, he gets in, you know, mathematically into this whole idea of 72. But that is besides the point. You know, why this point is important? Because, and here I would like to actually invoke Modelsky. Now, when Modelsky is, you know, in that piece, very fascinating piece, he says that they are elements of minimum solidarity in Kautilya's Arthashastra. And there is where I would see a reflection of Kautilya, not only to constructivism per se, but also to the School of International Relations, because order as a concept has been defined clearly by both in that context. So if order was a purposive arrangement of those sorts, I think, you know, this, but I then would not really restrict it to the English school also, though I do see a resonance there. Therefore, I try to go beyond paradigms, because one is really talking about how does one understand non-Western intellectual resources. And that I would be equally true when one studies Taoism, or when one tries to study even Islamic political thought. You know, we cannot just restrict ourselves to paradigms per se. And why, you know, just the last sentence, why I was so, so emphatic about this whole idea of the minimum solidarity element, or the idea of an ally being so important in Kautilya's Arthashastra, because later on when you look at the Arthashastra tradition, and again I would just go beyond what Quintin Skinner has already talked about, you know, the mythology of coherence and, you know, the text and the context interaction. You know, here if you really look at the tradition of Arthashastra per se, the tradition of Arthashastra, as I said, you know, mentions clearly this shadgunya policy. The tradition of Arthashastra also in Hitopadesha and Panchatantra, there the ally is significant. You know, so the idea of ally or the idea of a solidarity element, you know, in terms of conceptualizing state and external relations is very much present in ancient Indian texts. So that is the primary reason when one is really talking about anarchy as static. I would say that there is a fundamental difference here, because the departure point for understanding Arthashastra is that of order, not that of anarchy. And I would rest.
Jolly good. Rahul, you have to respond when you chair.
So, first of all, I did not come here to present a Kautilyan theory of international relations. My intent has been to present key concepts out of the Arthashastra, which are, with very few exceptions, unknown in the international community of political science and international relations in particular. I think there's a deficit to be made good for. The second is that what Kautilya writes in the Arthashastra that is relevant for interstate relations represents something original and singular, and that's not just my opinion. That is Morgenthau's opinion, who says, isn't it astonishing that among pre-modern authors on political theory, it is only Kautilya and Machiavelli that address questions of interstate relations in a systematic scholarly fashion at all. And it's a similar observation by Edward Watson, who says, isn't it astonishing that there is Kautilya, while among the Greek theoreticians, including Aristotle, interstate relations is no issue at all. Now, having said that, and with this I will conclude, what I do not understand, but probably that's my problem, what I do not understand is the recognition of the fact that these concepts which I try to outline here are antecedent of any intellectual concept generation in the West, and that by many hundred years, which I believe in and for itself is a matter of the utmost importance. And the more so since some of the Western theoreticians of political science and IR do have, I just mentioned two, do have recognized. Somehow this seemed to be somehow the elephant in the room, which I don't quite get, that the simple fact here is 300 BC theoretizations which then are approximated hundreds of years later, and that seems to be taken as something self-evident for granted, astonishes me. And the very last thing I want to say, that I would think to have a mechanical construction here is Kautilya's dislike for alliances and the non-alliance policy of Nehru, that there is a mechanical connection. I find it offensive that you would think I would have stated it like that. However, I do think that there are echoes, conceptual echoes, in terms of the position of non-alignment, and this position of positioning among the shadgunya, as well as the prakriti, and positioning alliance building very, very low in the ranking.
Thank you. It seems that the conversations are proceeding in an excellent way. I think that's how we I will allow the conversations to proceed under the stewardship of Associate Professor Rahul Mukherjee as of now, but before I do that, I would invite the audience to give a round of applause.